Homo sapiens. Who are we? Where do we come from? In chapter 15, we will take a more detailed look at modern humans in Africa. We will examine the rise of modernity or cultural complexity among modern humans as exhibited in their artwork and technology. The term modernity or behavioral modernity refers to the advent of modern human behavior, which is characterized by a host of skills or cultural traits. These skills or cultural traits would include skillful tool making, fishing, and long-distance barter, as well as the use of pigments and body adornments, the cooking and seasoning of foods, the utilization of marine food resources, and the making of symbolic or abstract artwork. Was this rise in cultural complexity or modernity sudden or gradual? And what stimulated the migration of modern humans out of Africa around the 60,000 year mark? We will attempt to answer these questions and more in chapter 15 by focusing on three main points of interest. 1. What are some key archaeological sites associated with modern humans in Africa, and what can they reveal about the appearance of behavioral modernity in Homo sapiens? 2. What is the evolutionary history of modern humans in Africa? Thirdly, what stimulated the migration of modern humans out of Africa sometime between 50,000 to 70,000 years ago? Let's start by tackling point number 1, some important archaeological sites associated with modern humans in Africa. These archaeological sites will be our window into the evolution of modern humans in Africa, especially as regards the rise of modernity or modern human behavior. We will be concentrating on archaeological sites in two countries in Africa, South Africa and Tanzania. There are a number of important sites in Africa stretching from South Africa to Ethiopia. For the purpose of keeping the length of this video reasonable, we will restrict ourselves to a few key sites in South Africa and Tanzania. In South Africa, we will look at the following sites: the Blumbos Cave site, the Klossies River Cave site, and the Deep Kloof Rock Shelter site. Moving north to Tanzania, we will look at the Mumba Rock Shelter site, which will provide some insight into the rise of human modernity in eastern Africa. Let me make a quick note concerning the historical time frame involved. In Africa, the period we will mostly be concerned with is known as the Middle Stone Age. Time-wise, this covers a period from roughly 280,000 years ago to roughly 40,000 years ago. We will be focusing on the time frame from roughly 80,000 to 40,000 years ago. Anatomically modern humans make their appearance in Africa around the 200,000 year mark. Traces of behaviorally modern humans begin to appear very roughly around the 75,000 year mark, as indicated by artifacts from the Blumbos Cave site in South Africa. The time frame of roughly 70,000 years ago to around 40,000 years ago is an important phase in the Middle Stone Age in Africa, as it seems to encompass the rise of modernity in Homo sapiens and witnesses the migration of modern humans out of Africa. The rise of modern human behavior or modernity from anatomically modern humans to behaviorally modern humans is a topic still undergoing scientific debate and research. As with any dynamic area of scientific study, new findings and discoveries continue to shape and modify pre-existing theories and ideas. The following archaeological sites we will be looking at will help provide some insight into the rise of modern human behavior in Africa and will hopefully answer some of the basic questions set forth at the beginning of this video. Let's start with the archaeological sites in South Africa. We will start with the Blumbos Cave site. The Blumbos Cave is located on the southern coast of South Africa in the Bloemfontein Nature Preserve, approximately 25 kilometers west of the town of Stilbaai. The cave site sits about 100 meters from the current shoreline at an elevation of about 35 meters above sea level. The Blumbos Cave site was first excavated in 1991 by Christopher Henselwood. From 1999 through 2011, 10 field seasons, each 6 weeks long, were carried out at the cave site. The Blumbos Cave was occupied by Homo sapiens off and on over a period dating from about 143,000 years ago to around 70,000 years ago during the Middle Stone Age.
The stone or lithic technology found at the Blombos site around the 70,000 year mark is characteristic of the Steele Bay lithic tradition of bifacially worked stone points. The seeming care to detail and concern for the appearance of the stone points may be evidence of social and stylistic elaboration indicative of rising modernity in human behavior. One of the most interesting finds at the Blombos site was a small piece of ochre, an iron-rich mineral, engraved or etched with a crosshatched design. This engraved ochre piece, along with other engraved pieces found at the site, are some of the earliest examples of objects thought to display a form of abstract or symbolic depiction or design. This ochre artifact, dated to around 75,000 years ago, may represent one of the earliest forms of symbolic design by modern humans. Abstract or symbolic thought is fundamental in generating complex cultural phenomena ranging from artwork to technology. Another very interesting find from the Blombos cave site, dated to around 100,000 years ago, is the discovery of ochre processing toolkits. The toolkit discovery consisted of two abalone shells along with ochre, bone, charcoal, grindstones, and hammer stones. The abalone shells were used to contain a liquefied, pigment-rich mixture. The pigment compound may have been used for painting or decorating a surface, though the exact usage is unknown. These toolkits are evidence for the first known instance of deliberate planning via the production of a pigmented compound, which was then stored in a container, the abalone shell. The abalone shells and toolkit items seems to hint at conceptual and cognitive abilities that are fundamental to modern human behavior. Dated at around 100,000 years ago, this seems to support the idea that modern human behavior was in evidence far earlier than previously thought. There were also about 30 bone tools found at the Blombos site in the form of awls and polished bone points. The awls may have been used to pierce soft materials such as animal skins. Some of the bone points may have served as projectile points. When we look at the craftsmanship of the bifacial stone points, the polished bone tools, the etched ochre pieces, and the shell beads found at the Blombos site, we see tools and personal ornaments made with care and forethought. With the dating of these finds to at least 70,000 years ago, the appearance of human modernity is pushed back at least 20,000 or more years beyond the 50,000 year mark espoused by the proponents of the Great Leap Forward or Upper Paleolithic Revolution school of thought. The broad range of subsistence behavior displayed by the humans at the Blombos site during the Middle Stone Age also reveals a great deal of resourcefulness. The final remains recovered reveal the use of a wide range of marine and terrestrial food resources. Among the food resources used by the inhabitants of the Blombos site were shellfish, tortoises, fish, ostrich eggs, and a range of mammals from the large eland down to the dune mole rat. There is also evidence for the hunting and eating of seals along the coast. Dolphin and whale meat was also consumed, but was most likely scavenged from the carcasses that had washed up along the beach. This broad-ranging subsistence behavior is consistent from the Middle Stone Age to the later Stone Age phases at the Blombos site. This seems to add further support for modern human behavior appearing well before the 50,000-year mark. Human remains at the Blombos site are sparse. Other than 7 teeth, no actual human remains have been found. Studies of the teeth found at the site point to an occupation by anatomically modern humans. Research at the Blombos cave site is ongoing. New discoveries there will no doubt further illuminate the nature of behavioral evolution in Homo sapiens. Next, we will look at the Colossides River cave site. The Colossides River cave site is located on the southern coast of South Africa, about 43 kilometers west of Cape St. Francis, just to the east of the mouth of the Colossides River. The Colossides site lies about 295 kilometers east of the Blombos site. The Colossides site consists of 3 main caves and 2 rock shelters. There is evidence for the Colossides site having been occupied by anatomically modern humans starting around 125,000 years ago. Some of the earliest archaeological work at the Colossides site was carried out by Ronald Singer and John Weimer around 1967. Hilary John Deacon continued research at the Colossides cave site starting in 1984. One of the most interesting finds from the Klossy site is a small piece of engraved ochre dated to around 100,000 years ago. This small piece of engraved ochre is thought to be the oldest known engraved object displaying possible evidence of symbolic behavior in early modern humans. The Middle Stone Age layers at the Klossy site from around the 70,000 year mark show significant changes from the earlier layers. There is also evidence in the exterior middens or refuse dumps of extensive cave cleaning by the 70,000 year mark. Cleaning or attention to housekeeping is considered a sign of modern human behavior. The stone tool industry associated with the layers dated to around 70,000 years ago is in the tradition of the Howison's Port Lithic industry with its microlithic characteristics. The stone tools, showing superior workmanship, were created from raw materials most likely obtained from sites approximately 20 kilometers inland. The ability to locate and utilize raw resources from distant areas is thought to be another hallmark of modern human behavior. Just as at the Blombos cave site, the modern humans at the Klossy's River cave site made extensive use of marine resources, especially shellfish. The brown mussel seems to have provided the bulk of the shellfish harvested along the shoreline by the Klossy's cave occupants. There is also evidence of a broad range of food resources being used, from plants, roots, and flowers to seals, penguins, eland, and Griesbach antelope. There is even some hint of cannibalism being practiced at the Klossy's River cave site. Human bones with cut marks and having been blackened by fire were found. Whether this cannibalism was ritualistic or predatory is unknown. There are also a number of hearths or small cooking areas at the cave site surrounded with the carbonized residue from the preparation of plant foods. The hearths are also associated with burnt shells and bones. The number of small separate hearths at the cave site may be evidence of separate family hearths as found in traditional San Bushman communities. The cooking and preparation of food resources is another marker of modern human behavior. The oldest human remains from the Klossy's River cave site are dated to about 110,000 years ago. They are some of the oldest known remains of anatomically modern humans in South Africa. The human remains are fragmentary with no indication of proper burial. The Klossy's River cave site and the Blombos cave site seem to attest to modern human behavior being in evidence around the 70,000 year mark. We find signs of modern humans making use of a wide range of food resources and having intricate stone tool technologies, as well as evidence for abstract or symbolic thought displayed in engraved objects. There is also evidence at both sites for some hint of modern human behavior in evidence as far back as 100,000 years ago. Let's now turn to the Deep Kloof rock shelter site near the west coast of South Africa. The Deep Kloof rock shelter site is located just inland along the western coast of South Africa. The site lies just east of the town of Alans Bay, about 17 kilometers inland from the mouth of the Vlorenvlei estuary. The rock shelter is located on a butte on the southern side of the Vlorenvlei estuary, about 600 meters from the shoreline. In this aerial view of the Deep Kloof site, we can get a good sense of its location and surroundings. Here is another view of the rock shelter from the side facing the Vlorenvlei estuary. This is the view from the Deep Kloof rock shelter looking toward the northeast, with the Vlorenvlei estuary in the midground. The rock shelter was no doubt a prime living location back in the Middle Stone Age. From an archaeological standpoint, the Deep Kloof rock shelter represents one of the most complete Middle Stone Age sequences in southern Africa, covering a period from at least 130,000 years ago to around 45,000 years ago. The site was first excavated in 1973 by John Parkington and Cedric Pogenpole, both affiliated with the University of Cape Town in South Africa. Since 1999, the site has been researched in a collaboration between the University of Cape Town and the French University of Bordeaux. One of the most interesting finds from the Deep Kloof site is the 400-plus pieces of etched ostrich eggshell. The pieces of ostrich eggshell dated to about 60,000 years ago exhibit intricate geometric designs of parallel lines, crosshatching, and repetitive non-parallel lines. The eggshells seem to have had a hole drilled in the top and are thought to have served as water containers or water flasks. The ostrich eggs average a volume of about 1 liter. The hunter-gatherers of the Kalahari in historic times were known to use ostrich shells as water containers. They also marked the shells for the purpose of denoting ownership or giving information as to what the shell contained. The intricately etched eggshells from Deep Kloof seem to provide further evidence for symbolic or abstract behavior in modern humans in southern Africa around the roughly 70 to 60,000 year mark during the Howison's Port phase at Deep Kloof. There is, however, an opposing view among some archaeologists as to what the Deep Kloof etched shells may represent. Archaeologists such as Thomas Wynn of the University of Colorado caution that these etchings could just represent some crude form of aesthetic artwork devoid of symbolic meaning. Ongoing field work and research will hopefully shed more light on these discoveries. Stone tool industries found in the Deep Kloof site sequences encompass pre-Steel Bay, Steel Bay, and Howison's Port through to post-Howison's Port lithic traditions ranging across a time span of about 107,000 years ago to around 50,000 years ago. Some of the raw materials used in making the stone tools excavated at Deep Kloof were transported to the rock shelter from sites 10 to 40 kilometers away. The modern humans at Deep Kloof also utilized a broad spectrum of food resources. A wide range of mammals was utilized, from rock hyrax, hares, and dune mole rats to zebra, wildebeest, and hippopotamus. Marine food resources such as shellfish and seal were also used. A barnacle from a whale was also found at the Deep Kloof site, possibly indicating scavenging of coastal resources. Plant resources were also an important part of the diet and material technologies of the modern humans at Deep Kloof. Plant materials from woods, grasses, seeds, and fruits were found in the Deep Kloof rock shelter. The human remains discovered at Deep Kloof are very sparse, consisting of 2-foot bones and a tooth. The remains are dated to between 45 to 65,000 years old. The foot bones and tooth fall within the range of variation of anatomically modern humans. The South African sites we have just looked at provide some insight into the rise of human behavioral modernity and the advent of more sophisticated cultural expression. One of the most salient aspects of the three sites we have covered is their close proximity to aquatic or marine resources. John Parkington, one of the leading excavators at the Deep Kloof site, hypothesizes that a diet utilizing aquatic or marine food resources, especially shellfish, may have helped stimulate encephalization in evolving modern humans. Encephalization refers to the tendency of a species to develop a larger brain-to-body mass ratio as the species evolves. Among mammals, humans have the greatest encephalization quotient. A study by Dr. Lee Broadhurst, a geochemist at the University of Maryland, found compelling evidence that the discovery and subsequent multi-generational exploitation of seafood coincides with the rapid expansion of the cerebral cortex that is unique to modern humans. What lies at the heart of the seafood and encephalization connection is the DHA molecule. DHA is short for docosahexaenoic acid. The chemical formula for the DHA molecule is C22H32O2. DHA is basically an omega-3 fatty acid that is a primary structural component of the human brain. The rudimentary source for DHA in the food chain is marine algae. As marine algae is at the bottom of the aquatic food chain, it propagates upward through shellfish and fish and eventually to humans who consume the marine creatures. The DHA molecule has unique structural properties that help facilitate a wide range of cell membrane functions. DHA is especially important in the human brain's gray matter, which is a membrane-rich tissue containing most of the brain's neuronal cell bodies. The gray matter regions of the brain are involved in muscle control, sensory perception, memory, emotions, speech, decision-making, and self-control. To quote from a scientific article on diet and encephalization by John Parkington, "Prominent among the requirements for encephalization are the lipids that constitute about 60% of all brain matter, more especially docosahexaenoic acid, the long-chain derivative of the omega-3 chain that is required on all synaptic junctions and retinal receptors. According to Parkington, Broadhurst, and others, access to marine food resources, especially shellfish, would have been a distinct advantage to modern humans in generating the fatty acid base in response to an evolutionary call for larger, more complex brains through the consumption of preformed DHA. From a nutritional standpoint, this is especially important in fetal development in the first year of postnatal life. Easy access to marine food resources may have been crucial in supplying pregnant mothers and newborns with this critical nutritional resource. In short, marine food resources may have played a key role in encephalization in anatomically modern humans, providing important nutrients for the evolving human brain. Our shore-dwelling ancestors with easy access to a high-quality, nutrient-rich diet may have been in the vanguard of encephalization in modern humans. This seaside life may have led to larger, more complex brains, which in turn facilitated innovation and more complex cultural expression, the hallmarks of modernity in the human species. The relatively easy access to marine food resources may have also allowed our ancestors more free time, which they applied to crafting more refined tools, as well as creating more elaborate artwork. This synergistic mix of a nutrient-rich diet, which facilitated brain growth, and more leisure time for experimentation and the pursuit of innovation may have kickstarted modern human behavior along the southern coast of Africa during the Middle Stone Age. Let's now move farther north up into eastern Africa to Tanzania and the Mumba Rock Shelter site. The Mumba Rock Shelter is located in northern Tanzania on the eastern side of Lake Eyasi, about 62 kilometers south of the Olduvai Gorge. The rock shelter's distance from Lake Eyasi fluctuates between 2 to 4 kilometers as the lake level rises and falls with the changing climatic conditions. The rock shelter is located at the base of a massive outcrop of Precambrian rock. The overhanging rock face is slight, so it provides little protection from the elements, but it has attracted many inhabitants over thousands of years. The archaeological sequences at Mumba represent one of the most complete found in eastern Africa, encompassing a range from the Middle Stone Age to the Iron Age. The Mumba site was first excavated in 1934 by Ludwig and Margit Kohl Larsen. Margit carried out a more extensive excavation in 1938, with large amounts of artifacts and fossils being shipped back to Germany for study and display. The early Kohl Larsen excavations at the Mumba site lacked the scientific rigor necessary for accurate dating of the archaeological sequences. In 1977, Michael Melman undertook further excavations at the Mumba site, attempting to clarify the dating of the stratigraphy. Melman's main interest was the Middle to Later Stone Age transition in eastern Africa. From 2005 through 2009, further work was done to date the chronological layers at Mumba with greater accuracy by Mary Prendergast and other researchers. The most current effort to date the Mumba site's 6 beds or levels was carried out by Luke Leganek and associates using optically stimulated luminescence and infrared stimulated luminescence. If we look at this graphic of the stratigraphy of the Mumba site based on research by Leganek and others, we can see the basic chronological structure of the Mumba site. The stratigraphy encompasses 6 archaeological beds, which are subdivided into various levels. The lowest level is bed 6B, which is dated across a range of 109,000 to 130,000 years old. The dates for bed 6B were arrived at by Melman and associates using uranium dating methods. Obsidian tools thought to have been derived from raw sources 320 kilometers away were discovered in bed 6B. Leganek and associates dated the bed 6A sequence at Mumba to around 74,000 years BP before present. Bed 6A also contained obsidian tools created from a raw obsidian source located 320 kilometers away. Microliths, or small specialized stone tools, appear around the roughly 57,000 year mark at Mumba in the lower part of bed 5. There are also work pieces of red and yellow ochre from bed 5 which are at least 50,000 years old. Around the roughly 49,000 year mark in the upper level of bed 5, we begin to find ostrich eggshell beads that were used for personal adornment, another indicator of modernity in human cultures. These ostrich eggshell beads are some of the earliest definitive signs of modernity in Eastern Africa. Bed 4 is a sterile layer, meaning no human artifacts are present. This is due to the rock shelter being submerged by Lake Eyasi during the laying down of Bed 4, which occurred across a span from 43,000 years ago to 37,000 years ago. Human habitation at the rock shelter resumes around the 37,000 year mark in Bed 3, with the appearance of numerous ostrich eggshell beads, a bone point, and back microlithic stone tools, all associated with modern human technologies and behavior. Overall, these findings at the Mumba site seem to hint at the appearance of modernity at least by the 60,000 to 50,000 year mark along the shores of Lake Eyasi. An even earlier sign of modern human behavior at Lake Eyasi may be indicated by the obsidian tools from Bed 6B. Chemical testing on the obsidian tools from Bed 6B indicated that they were chemically similar to a source of raw obsidian located 320 kilometers northeast of the Mumba site in the Njorwa Gorge. This 320-kilometer source-to-use distance of the raw obsidian may indicate the existence of trade or exchange networks over long distances. Luke Gliganic writes, "The regularity of the appearance of distantly sourced obsidian in many Middle Stone Age and later Stone Age assemblages in East Africa strengthens the hypothesis that regional exchange networks for raw materials existed in East Africa during the Middle Stone Age and later Stone Age." The dating of the Mumba site's Bed 6A to around 74,000 years old seems to set a minimum antiquity for the Lake Eyasi exchange networks to at least 74,000 years. This may indicate the existence of modern human behavior prior to the 74,000 year mark in the Lake Eyasi area. Another interesting aspect of the Mumba stone tool industry circa 60,000 years ago at the Mumba site is its similarity with the Howison's Port stone tool industry of southern Africa. Today, the Lake Eyasi area is home to the Hadza people, or Hadzabi, a population of hunter-gatherers who speak an isolated Click language. The San Bushmen of southern Africa are also Click language speakers. It is thought that the San Bushmen and the Hadzabi may have shared a common ancestor from which they diverged around the 55,000 year mark. Whether any Middle Stone Age connection exists between the Mumba site and the distant sites in southern Africa based on stone tool industry similarities is speculative. The northernmost known site for the Howison's Port industry is the Caves of Hearth site located in the Makapanskat Valley in South Africa, some 2,000 kilometers south of the Mumba site. It is reasonable to speculate that the San Bushmen and Hadzabi people may be remnants of a once widespread Click language population of modern humans that existed from southern Africa through eastern Africa prior to the 55,000 year mark. At present, however, there is no evidence for a connection between the sites in South Africa and Tanzania and their respective stone tool industries. Future research may shed a light on a possible connection. Climate may also have played a role in the rise of modernity in the Lake Eyasi area. The transition from marine isotope stage 4 to marine isotope stage 3 occurs around the 57,000 year mark. This climatic transition is marked by a change from a more arid or dry climate pattern to one more humid, resulting in subsistence and environmental changes for the human populations in eastern Africa. These climatic changes coincide with the technological changes seen at the Mumba site around the roughly 60,000 year mark. To quote Luke Gliganic, "Given the concurrence of technological and climatic change at approximately 60,000 years ago, it is reasonable to hypothesize that favorable changes in the environment at the beginning of marine isotope stage 3 may have led to increases in human populations around Lake Eyasi, leading to increased innovations, more varied technologies, and altered subsistence strategies. The arid conditions of the marine isotope stage 4 period, which existed from roughly 71,000 to 57,000 years ago, may have presented climatic conditions that reduced and isolated the population of modern humans in Africa. The more favorable conditions of marine isotope stage 3, starting roughly around the 57,000-year mark, may have allowed for population expansion, which facilitated greater socialization, which in turn facilitated the spread of ideas and technologies across eastern Africa, with the possibility of some contribution from the southern coast of Africa. The stratigraphy at the Mumba site provides a nice glimpse into the rise of human modernity in eastern Africa. Its revelation of the possibility of long-distance exchange networks existing prior to the 74,000-year mark hints at modern human behavior being in evidence well before the 50,000-year mark. The sites we have looked at in South Africa and Tanzania give some insight into the rise of human modernity in Africa. From an archaeological standpoint, some of the earliest signs of human modernity appear around the 75,000-year mark at the Blombos site in South Africa. There is also an argument for some signs of modern human behavior around the 100,000-year mark at the Blombos and Klasse's River Caves sites. At the Mumba site in Tanzania, we see signs of modernity around the 50,000-year mark with the appearance of ostrich eggshell beads for personal adornment. We also see evidence for long-distance exchange networks in existence prior to the 74,000-year mark. These findings seem to support a gradual rise in modern human behavior across a broad range of time. From the 100,000-year mark through to the 50,000-year mark, the dynamic synergy of diet, climate, and demographics may have worked to stimulate the rise of modernity in the population of anatomically modern humans from the south to the north of Africa. As archaeological research in Africa expands, the horizon for the appearance of human modernity is being pushed far back beyond the 50,000-year mark. The rise of modernity was no doubt scattered and sporadic to some degree across the African landscape. It may have arisen then faded as cultures waxed and waned due to climatic conditions or changes as yet uncharted. Continuing research in Africa will help clarify the circumstances of the rise of human modernity. To make a quick synopsis of modern humans in Africa and beyond, we can say that anatomically modern humans appear roughly around the 200,000-year mark. Around the roughly 100,000-year mark, we begin to see hints of modern human behavior in southern Africa along the coast. By the 75,000-year mark, we begin to see more elaborate artwork and more sophisticated technologies appearing as witnessed by the sites of Blombos, Klasse's River Caves, and Diepkloof. Around the roughly 57,000-year mark, with the favorable climatic changes of marine isotope stage 3, expanding populations and the resulting population pressures may have caused modern humans to move out of Africa eastward into the Arabian Peninsula, pushing eventually into India and eastward into Asia. The mastery of the use of marine food resources may have helped facilitate the movement of modern humans out of Africa using the coast of the Arabian Peninsula as a migration route eastward. Around the roughly 40,000-year mark, expanding populations of modern humans were pushing northward into Europe, where they eventually replaced the fading Neanderthal populations by the 30,000-year mark. With the advent of marine isotope stage 1 around the 14,000-year mark through to the warmer, more stable climatic conditions of the Holocene at the 11,700-year mark, we begin to find modern humans adapting new lifestyle behaviors. The nomadic behavior of the hunter-gatherer lifestyle is slowly replaced in some regions by a more sedentary lifestyle. The advent of agriculture and the domestication of animals, especially in the Levant and areas of the Middle East, herald big changes for modern humans in the world. Starting in the Levant around the 10,000-year mark, we begin to see the rise of agriculture in the beginning of the Neolithic Revolution. Agriculture and the domestication of animals, such as goats and cattle, lead to higher population densities, which in turn lead to the rise of civilizations. The earliest civilizations appear in Mesopotamia and present-day Iraq, with the Sumerian civilization around 5,500 years ago, and in present-day Egypt along the Nile River around 5,000 years ago. Advances in genetics, dating methods, as well as archaeological and scientific techniques will continue to illuminate the evolution and history of Homo sapiens. Each day, these scientific efforts bring us a little closer to knowing who we are and where we came from. Through the last 15 chapters, we have largely concentrated on the evolution of Homo sapiens and our ancestors over the last 7 million years. In chapter 16, we are going to take a great leap backward in time to look at the beginnings of life on planet Earth. If we think about it, we and every living thing on Earth represents an unbroken chain back to the first life on Earth. Our DNA is just a very evolved and modified version of the DNA of the first living creature in the DNA chain of life that came into being some 3+ billion years or so in the past. In chapter 16, we will seek to find the very roots of our human family tree in the primordial myths of our ancient past.